Happy Sabbath, everyone. Welcome to the Sabbath School, lesson number 10, Doing the Unthinkable. I want to thank Brother Mark Passion and Sister Cindy De La Peña. Our Father in Heaven, we ask that you forgive us from our sins. Be merciful to us, Lord. Give us wisdom and understanding as we study your word. Bless those who are watching and listening, Lord. Bless also us as we discuss your word to your children. Thank you for hearing our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So just a quick overview. Our lesson is very nice, right, Mark?
Yes.
And Sister Cindy, it's very nice. It's about Jesus. It's like the whole Bible. So our memory text, Sister Cindy.
Our memory text is found in Isaiah 53, verse 5. It says, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed."
Wow, this verse is very loaded, Brother Mark. Yeah, I want to really stop in this verse. Wounded for our transgressions. If you want to talk, you just tell me, because I really like to ponder on this, because I have many transgressions. Bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement for our peace was upon him. You know, when we sin, we have no peace, but because of Jesus Christ, peace comes to us. And this is one of the, you are a nursing graduate. By his stripes, we are healed. Sometimes we wonder, how come my wound gets healed? How come when we get sick, we get healed? I think this is one of the explanations. Because Jesus Christ was beaten, that's why we are healed. What can you say, Brother Mark?
You know, it's pretty interesting how it says here that he was wounded for transgressions. If you look at the language portrayed in this verse specifically, it says, I mean, keep in mind these words, wounded, bruised, and then healed. There is this idea that suffering equates to healing. And it's only through Christ, through his suffering, can we experience true healing. Healing from sin, healing from bad relationships, healing from, I mean, you name it, all the sin that you could think about. There's this idea that because of his suffering, we can receive healing in our own life.
Wow, that's so profound. In Philippians 2:7, it further says, "But made himself of no reputation." You know, sometimes we get demoted, but Jesus Christ, he was, if you're up here, it's like very hard to go down, right? Humanly speaking, but Jesus Christ, he was God, and he made himself of no reputation. You know, sometimes I wonder, where am I going to sleep? But I remember, at least it's better than a manger. "Taking the form of a bond servant and coming in the likeness of men." Sometimes, you know, when I read this one, I want to be a servant also. I want to be like Jesus, you know. It's like, it doesn't matter who you are. If there's something lowly that needs to be done, Jesus is the best example. Now let's look at Sunday. Isaiah's testing truth. Wow. Isaiah 54:10. "The Lord God has given me the tongue of the learned." Is this correct, Mark? This "me" is Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Okay. "That I should know how to speak a word in season to him who is weary. He awakens me morning by morning." So this is Isaiah's prophecy given to him by the Holy Spirit about Jesus. And we will see later, if we have time, the fulfillments of these prophecies. Wow. "He awakens me morning by morning." Wow. If you want to be like Jesus, you know, you can pray that the Holy Spirit will wake you up morning by morning to meditate on his word, to awaken. "He awakens my ear to hear us the learned." Okay, wow. You know, Jesus likes to listen to his teachers. Jesus likes to listen to God's word. "The Lord has opened my ear. I was not rebellious, nor did I turn away. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those." Wow, how come Jesus was not a boxer? Because he submits. You know, he said, if you are hit in one cheek, you give the other cheek. So I think there is no place for a pugilistic sports in Jesus' ministry. "And my cheek to those who plucked out the bird." He's not retaliatory, yeah? "I did not hide my face from shame and spit." Okay, now your turn. You enjoy it.
You know, there's this idea here in this text of the humility of Jesus. This self-sacrificing love mixed with humility. And it's just interesting how Jesus didn't fight back. Jesus didn't puff himself up into notice. Jesus didn't seek for attention.
I agree with that. But one thing that I also saw here is we see his humility, but even in spite of, so we see from verses 5 down to 10, how the people were like mocking Jesus, spitting on him, just mocking him face to face. And in verse 4, it says that he should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. So imagine, like, you are suffering yourself. Like, people don't really like you. People are mocking you, are persecuting you. But your desire is still to those who are weary, to lift up those who are on the ground. So it's like he went so low.
Yeah, furthermore, it says here, I did not hide my face from shame and spitting. This happened, right?
Yes.
You know, people spit in Jesus' face and they tried to put him to shame. For the Lord God will help me, therefore I will not be disgraced. It's amazing how Jesus himself was God, but he depended on his Father in heaven. Therefore, I have set my face like a flint, and I know that I will not be ashamed. You see, I think a flint is something small, yeah? Even if everybody else is persecuting him, you know, the truth is stable. He is near who justifies me, who will contend with me. Wow! If God is on our side, the Bible says, who can be against us, right? The whole world, no problem. I mean, let us stand together. Who is my adversary? Let him come near me. Surely the Lord God will help me. Who is he who will condemn me? Indeed, they will all grow like old, like a garment. It's true. If people are persecuting us, they're gonna grow old and die. But the moth will eat them up. Moths are small things. And imagine your enemies will be eaten by a moth. Who among you fears the Lord? Who obeys the voice of his servant? Who walks? My friends watching, if you see the text, there are capital H that's talking about Jesus Christ's servant. Who walks in darkness and has no light. Let him trust in the name of the Lord and rely upon his God. Wow. So if you are in the darkness of your life, trust in the Lord.
The contrast between humility and when someone is self-exalted. Satan wanted to be the very top, and he sought to be like the Most High, as it says in Isaiah 14 and Ezekiel 28. So Satan strived to hit the top. But Jesus, on the other hand, he was at the top, but he descended lower and lower to be at our own level, as it mentions in Philippians 2. Let this mind be in Christ, which was also in Christ Jesus, who took on the form of a bondservant and suffered the shame even to the death of the cross. In the end, we know he will be, as Revelation 20, he will be cast into the lake of fire. But Jesus, even though he suffered the second death, he was resurrected from the grave, and now he is heaven.
Okay, let's continue. Isaiah 49:7. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel. You know, when I hear this Redeemer, I'm so happy. Because redeemed, you know, it benefits us all. Redeemed, their Holy One, to him whom man despises, to him whom the nations abhor. You know, sometimes, do you ever feel that people don't like you, you know, for some reason, for whatever? Jesus Christ can relate with us. He is to him whom man despises, to him whom the nations abhor. Do you ever, the people hate you because of righteousness' sake, because of truth? Jesus also, that happened to Jesus. So we are in the same place of Jesus if that happens to you. Kings shall see and arise. Princes also shall worship because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel. And he has chosen you. Wow. Jesus Christ is the center of all this. Very nice prophecy.
That Jesus came to his own and his own received him not.
Yeah, it's interesting as well because I read that there are two representations of Jesus coming. One is as a lamb and the other is as a lion.
Okay, in continuation to what Brother Mark said, we have to know Jesus. And I was praying how for many weeks, because people were talking about Jesus, and I was praying, how will I know if I know Jesus? Because I know the Holy Spirit, but Jesus, he went away already a long time ago. So I was praying to God, where in the Bible can we measure if we know Jesus? And then the Holy Spirit gave us this verse in 1 John 2:3, the objective rubric if we know to measure how we know Jesus. Let me read it. Now by this we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. Wow. Man, when I read this, I was so happy because we have the measurement. rubric measurable, you know, in nursing, measurable. In the academics, it's a rubric of how we know Jesus, if we keep. So you just list all the commandments and then check, check, check. And that's how you know Jesus. And then that is what I understand from this verse.
So we also see in 2 Samuel 10 verse 1 to 12, to summarize it, King David attacked and conquered the country of Ammon because the king of Ammon seized David's envoys, shaved off half of the beard of each, cut off their garments in the middle of their hips, and sent them away. So it's like experiencing the same humiliation and mocking that Jesus experienced.
Yeah, thank you so much. You know, in the last verse of that battle, there's a very nice text. Be of good courage. Let us be strong for our people and for the cities of our God. Wow. You know, when you are in God's side, fighting for God, I mean, God is so big, but He gives you the opportunity to, with your small capability, to work for Him. It's so amazing. And may the Lord do what is right, good in His sight. Wow. So, really, God can do everything, but He gives us opportunity also to help us in doing the mission. Now, there's another verse here about Jesus Christ, Isaiah 6, 9, 6, and 7. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice, from that time forward, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Wow. Okay. There, in Isaiah 11, 1-16, this is the reign of Jesse's offspring. There shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. Wow, that is the best thing that can happen, when the Spirit of the Lord rests on Jesus Christ, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding. That's why the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, right? The Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. I still remember Ron Clouzet's book, Adventism's Greatest Need, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Wow. His delight is in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears. Not like us humans, we look and we hear, and then we judge according to our senses, but Jesus Christ reads the heart. But with righteousness, he shall judge the poor. Wow. Many of us are poor. Sometimes we think it's not fair. But Jesus Christ comes to our rescue and decide with equity. Nadaya, have you been cheated? Jesus Christ comes with equity for the meek of the earth. Are we too meek? Are you too meek to complain, to fight for your rights? Jesus Christ is behind you. He takes note of everything, and he will refund you of all your sufferings when you work for him. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. This is going to happen in the last days, right? This is a prophecy that when Jesus comes, righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, and faithfulness the belt of his waist. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb. I think this is now in heaven. Yeah, the wolf shall dwell with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the young goat. The calf and the young lion and the fatling together. And you know, when this I watch National Geographic or the TV where the lions attack the other animals, I am very sad, because all of these things happen because of our sins. And our domain suffers also. But in heaven, they will be nice to each other. The cow and the bear shall graze. Their young ones shall lie together. The lion shall eat straw like... Oh, even the lion, Mark, is vegetarian. Huh? Interesting. The nursing child shall play by the cobra's hole, and the wind child shall put his hand in the viper's den. Ah, very scary now, but in heaven, you can do it. They shall not... Do you want to go to heaven, my friend? Read this one. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy nations. No more wild animals. All the animals in heaven are kind. For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord. When everybody has knowledge of God, nobody attacks each other, right? Even the animals, they are kind. And in that day there shall be the root of Jesse. I think this is Jesus Christ because it's capital. Who shall stand as the banner, a banner to the people. For the Gentiles, when I read Gentiles, I always know that we are not Jews, right? It's the Jews, and the Jews, everybody who is not Jew is Gentile. And all Filipinos are Gentiles, but we have become Jews through the grafting. For the Gentiles shall seek him, and his resting place shall be glorious. That's why if you want to be saved, Jesus Christ is our solution only. It shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people. Usually the remnant when everybody else is doing evil, those who are faithful, they are the remnant. And God will retrieve and recover who are left from Syria and Egypt and Patros and Cush and Elam and Shinar and all the islands of the sea. So from different, wow, this is very nice because all the God's children are going to go to heaven. He will set up a banner for the nations and will assemble the outcasts of Israel. Do you feel like an outcast sometimes? Yeah. Jesus will assemble the outcasts of Israel and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. Also, have you been persecuted and run away from your home, Israel? Jesus Christ will unite us again, and the adversaries of Judah shall be cut off. Ephraim shall not envy Judah. Do we envy each other in ministry? Huh? We have so many views and some people have no views. But in heaven, we will not envy each other because we will be united, but they shall fly down upon the shoulder of the Philistines. They used to be enemies, but now they shall fly down upon the shoulder of the Philippines. Philistines. Together they shall plunder the people of the east. You know what plunder means? That means later, the meek shall inherit the earth. Yeah, that's another meaning. They shall lay their hand on Edom and Moab and the people of Ammon. These used to be enemies of the Israelites, shall obey them. The Lord will utterly destroy the tongue of the sea of Egypt. They used to be slaves here in Egypt, but now the Lord will destroy the tongue of the sea of Egypt and with his mighty wind. The wind, remember the wind in Egypt, he will shake his fist over the river and strike it in the seven streams and make men cross over dry shod. Oh, it's like a reminder of what happened when they exited Egypt. There will be a highway of the remnant of his people who will be left from Assyria. It's like from slavery, there is a highway from this world, from Assyria, from the enemies, there is a highway going to heaven. As for it was for Israel in the day that it came up, or as it was for Israel. That means it will be like that, yeah? And everybody will go to heaven. It's a very nice prophecy. It's like the whole great controversy is written there in Isaiah. Amazing. In Isaiah 52:13, behold my servant. You know, servant, when it says servant, it's very humble, yeah? To be called a servant, shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. Just as many were astonished as you, so his visage was marred more than any man. So this looks like Jesus Christ was so taxed or so tired, and his form more than the sons of men. Do you feel like you are tired sometimes? Read this verse. Jesus Christ was also a servant, and he took all the load that we had. So shall he sprinkle many nations. But because he did that, he's going to help many people, including us. Kings shall shut their mouths at him, for what had not been told them they shall see, and what they had not heard they shall consider. So it is a great opportunity to be like Jesus and to execute God's will here on earth.
So Isaiah 53 verse 1 through 12, talking about the sin-bearing Messiah, it says here, verse 1, who hath believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him.
Wait. I have to interrupt. Jesus Christ was not very handsome. So don't worry if you're not handsome. It says here, he has no form or comeliness. When we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. On the other hand, Satan was the most beautiful, I think. So we have to be careful if we think we are handsome or beautiful. Yeah. Can I continue? Because I really like to read this. He is despised and rejected. I mean, the reason I want to read this is because I sometimes feel despised and rejected by many people. I don't know why, but when I read this, I really feel that Jesus Christ, I can relate to Jesus Christ. He was despised and rejected by men. A man of sorrows, my friend. Are you in sorrow? Read this verse. A man of sorrows. Not only one sorrow or three sorrows. His life was sorrow. And he is a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Have you ever cried and cried and cried? Jesus Christ felt all that you are suffering. He is a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief.
These words do not mean that Christ was unattractive in person. In the eyes of the Jews, Christ had no beauty that they should desire him. They looked for a Messiah who would come with outward display and worldly glory. one who would do great things for the Jewish nation, exalting it above every other nation on the earth. But Christ came with his divinity hidden by the garb of humanity, unobtrusive, humble, and poor. They compared this man with the proud boasts that they had made, and they could see no beauty in him. They did not discern the holiness and purity of his character. The grace and virtue revealed in his life did not appeal to them.
Yeah, thank you so much for that. I have never read that one, but it's really, it helps us understand what this means. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely, wow, this is one of my favorites, man. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. When Jesus hung on the cross, he took all our grief and our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement, this is the second time we're reading it, but I really like it. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We are sheep. We don't know we are lost, and we don't know how to go home. We have turned everyone to his own way. The Bible is so simple, but we have so many ideas, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. I really feel so, undeserving, because this is Jesus Christ. I mean, he is God, and he suffered all our sins.
Christ was treated as we deserve, that we might be treated as he deserves. He was condemned for our sins, in which he had no share, that we might be justified by his righteousness, in which we had no share. He suffered a death which was ours, that we might receive the life which was his. With his stripes we are healed. So it's like, imagine the great exchange of what is meant to be ours, and he took that from us, and he gave us something that we do not deserve at all.
Yeah, he is like the Lamb of God. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth like a lamb. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. He didn't open it when he was being interrogated. Yeah, he didn't speak. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. Jesus Christ died. That means for the transgressions. For why did he die? For the transgressions of my people he was stricken, and they made his grave with the wicked. It is true, but with the rich at his death. Oh, this happened. Everything happened because he had done no violence. Jesus Christ did not sin, nor was any deceit in his mouth. So Isaiah says, woe unto us, woe unto me, a man of unclean lips, dwelling with the people of unclean lips. When we see Jesus Christ, when we understand him, we feel very evil compared to him. But Jesus Christ did not tell any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand.
Because by his stripes we are healed. So if Jesus did not have stripes, if he was not bruised, how can we be healed? How can we be healed of sin?
Okay, these are really very deep. It means one thing, it means many things, but everything is, we will understand in heaven. But it gives us a clue. He shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many. For that includes us, yeah? For he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul unto death. That means he died voluntarily, and he was numbered with the transgressors. He was crucified with the two thieves, and he bore the sin of many and made intercession for us, the transgressors. And there are more prophecies. Isaiah 7 says, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and he shall call his name Emmanuel. Emmanuel means?
God with us.
Yeah. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name. I feel like singing this. You know, have you heard the Messiah concert? And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, etc. All the nice things.
So on Wednesday's lesson is entitled The Unreachable Is Us, which is found in Isaiah 53 verses 3 to 9. And I'll let Cindy read these verses.
Isaiah 53 verses 3 to 9, he is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes. There is nothing save the selfish heart of men. That means there is nothing except the selfish heart of man that lives unto itself.
Yeah, that's very nice. Not only that, it's worse. Galatians 3:13 says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us.
Very heavy word.
Yeah, very heavy and terrible word. And, you know, God took our place. Curse is everyone who hangs on a tree. We should have been hanging on that tree like forever, but Jesus Christ, you know, reached us, unreachable. It's like you don't have load or you don't have signal or your phone is broken. But Jesus Christ got you anyway. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, he made him who knew no sin. You know, sometimes something happens to some people, they are bad, it's okay. But you know, when something happens to good people, oh, kawawa naman, or, you know, but when something happens to good people, and it is your fault that something happened to good people. It's like you hit somebody with your car and it's very innocent. I don't know how to explain it, but it really bothers you. And that happened to Jesus Christ because of all our sins. Him, he knew no sin. He became sin for us. Okay, now that we understood all the great and marvelous things about Jesus Christ, what he did, the question is, what can we do in response? Yeah? The claim of redemption in Amazing Grace, page 172, Testimonies, volume 6 also, page 479, it says in chapter 60, the claim of redemption. Since we were saved, what is our opportunity? You know, if somebody did something to you, you are very grateful, you want to do something also, you know. You cannot be saved and not do anything. Tithes and offerings are for God, an acknowledgement of his claim on us by creation. You know, this is tithe and offering. It looks like negative because it will reduce your money. But actually, it is a great opportunity, my friend. I have tried giving tithe. I have also tried stealing tithe. Stealing tithe is a great curse. I can tell many stories about that, my personal stories and our ministry stories. But tithe is one of the greatest opportunities, and offering for God are an acknowledgement of his claim on us by creation. And they are also an acknowledgement of his claim by redemption. Because God created us, we give tithe and offering. Because God redeemed us, man, I think we have to give everything. Huh? Nothing else. You know, when Nicodemus understood John chapter 3, which Jesus told him directly, Ellen G. White says that he ran out of money helping the apostles. So when we understand salvation and how it will benefit, I think we will spend all our money like Zacchaeus to also save others. Because all our power is derived from Christ, these offerings are to flow. You know, these days, it's COVID season. We don't know when we are going to die. Yeah, sorry for that statement, but it's very scary. We never know. They are to keep ever before us the claim of redemption, the greatest of all claims, and the one that involves every other. The realization of the sacrifice made in our behalf is ever to be fresh in our minds and is ever to exert an influence on our thoughts and plans. There is a part here that really struck me. Compute this. How much owest thou unto my Lord? How much, Mark, how much do you have to pay Jesus Christ for your salvation? I mean, how much do you owe God, my friend Cindy? Yeah? We cannot compute. It says here, how much owest thou unto my Lord? Compute this, you cannot, since all that you have is his. Will you hold from him that which he claims? That is the tithe and offering. He calls for it. Will you selfishly grasp it as your own? Will you keep it back and apply it to some other purpose than the salvation of souls? Oh, my friend, don't try to do that. It is a curse from my experience. I can tell you, it is in this way that thousands of souls are lost because some people don't give tithe and offering. Thousands of souls are lost. I can just give the offering for them so that I can save those thousands of souls. How can we better show our appreciation of God's sacrifice, his great donation to our world, than by sending forth gifts and offerings with thanks and giving from our lips because of the great love wherewith he has loved us and drawn himself? Wow, you know, I really like this topic because it's about money. and it's about salvation of souls, and it's very exciting. Like the guy who, from the prison, yeah, he said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? You know, sitting in church is might be boring for you, watching live stream might be boring for you. And one president said, the wife said, what happened in church? He said, nothing. Why nothing? Because the preacher did not tell me to do anything. You know, understanding things is one thing, but doing something is the most exciting thing. It's not boring. Lord, what will thou have me to do? He was told. And the answer is, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Mark 6:15. When you see souls in the kingdom of God saved through your gifts and your service, will you not rejoice that you had the privilege of doing this work? Wow. Of the apostles of Christ, it is written, they went forth, preached everywhere, and the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Mark 16:20.
It's wonderful to think that our God is a giver. He gave, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. I mean, like, what kind of a God would give up his only son? It's not so much how much you give, but do you give with the heart? How much of your heart is God's? That's why everything that we have, everything that we own, everything that we accumulate is not ours. It's all from God.
Yeah. Stewardship is one of my favoritest topic. That's why I really like. And actually, if you compute that to the end, it says in 2 Corinthians 6, thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift. You cannot compute the benefits that God gave us. Furthermore, it says in Leviticus 6, 1-7, it's about the laws of the burnt offering, the grain offering, and the sin offering. And the Lord spoke to Moses saying, if a person sins and commits a trespass against the Lord by lying. Sometimes people don't want to talk about sins, but it's in the Bible. We have to identify, and otherwise we don't know what to repent about. By lying. So lying is a sin to his neighbor, what was delivered to him for safekeeping, or about a pledge, or about robbery is also a sin. Or if he has extorted, his extortion is also a sin. Or he has found what is lost and lies concerned. They didn't give the lost ATM or lost wallet, and swears falsely. It's in any one of these things that any man may do in which he sins, it is a sin. Then it shall be because he has sinned and is guilty, he shall restore what he has stolen. So if you steal something, we have to return. And or the thing which he has extorted, return. And what was delivered to him. That's why it's transforming. We have to return what we stole. Or what was delivered to him for safekeeping, or the lost thing which he found, or all that about. For he shall restore its full value. And add 1/5 more to it, my interest, and give it to whomever it belongs on the day of his trespass offering. And he shall bring his trespass offering to the Lord, a ram without blemish from the flock, with your valuation as a trespass offering to the priest. So the priest shall make atonement for him before the Lord. So sin separates us from God. But because of this sacrifice, Jesus Christ's sacrifice, we can become at one with God again. And he shall be forgiven. Wow. For any one of these things that he may have done in which he trespasses. So my friend, though our sins be as scarlet because of Jesus Christ's sacrifice in the cross, we can be forgiven. We can be as white as snow, and God will throw our sins in the bottom of the sea. Ellen White says that God abhors every species of dishonesty. Oh, very heavy phrase. Every species of dishonesty. And you know, if you have ever cheated, if you have ever used pirated software, if you are still using now, you have copied MP3s illegally, or movies, or cracked software, or photocopied book illegally. All of these small things, Jesus suffered for them. We are not serious about them, but God can forgive us from our sins. There is no reason we will not repent, because God can forgive us from our sins. Praise the Lord. I just want to read this, Psalm 32, 1 and 2. The Bible is not full of condemnation and definition of sin and making us feel guilty, but it is a book of forgiveness. It says in Psalm 32, 1 and 2 says, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. Wow. But God, this is one of the other favorite verse, Romans 5:8. Do you want to read it? I get to enjoy all the reading.
Romans 5 verse 8 says, but God demonstrates his love, his own love towards us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
That really strikes me. We were still sinners. Christ died for us. We didn't know what to do. We were doing foolishness, and Christ was suffering for us. When we understand this, we will really hate sin.
I think I would just like to add that to that as well, Sir Win. I read in the Sabbath school lesson that Christ's death magnifies the law. To expound on that, it's like the seeing what sin did to Jesus, it tells you of like the seriousness, that a word, seriousness of the law. Because it says, Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. And we see that death. Jesus died that death.
Ellen White, she says here, Christ our Savior, in whom dwelt absolute perfection, became sin for the fallen race. He did not know sin by the experience of sinning, but he bore the terrible weight of the guilt of the whole world. He became our propitiation, that all who receive him may become sons of God. That's the hope that we have. We can become brothers and sisters or sons of God. And then it says, the cross was erected to save man. Christ lifted on the cross was the means devised in heaven for awakening in the repenting soul a sense of the sinfulness of sin. So in other words, the cross was to awaken our minds how bad sin is. And then she says, by the cross, Christ sought to draw all to himself. If I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto myself. And then she says, he died as the only hope of saving those who, because of sin, were in the gall of bitterness. Through the agency of the Holy Spirit, a new principle of mental and spiritual power was to be brought to man, who, through association with divinity, was to become one with God. And hence the name Emmanuel, God with us. We can be one with God. I mean, if you think about how God pursued man, even, you know, Jesus came to this world, you know, in the most holy place. And if you think in terms of the sanctuary, he said to Moses in Exodus 25:8, let them build me a sanctuary that I may dwell among my people, among them. He wanted to dwell with them. And being in the most holy place can only get so far. I mean, the only person that could go in the most holy place was the priest, the high priest. But Jesus went beyond that. He stepped down from his throne and took on the form of a human being and became our servant, our redeemer. And because of that, now he can dwell with his people. And in the end, in Revelation 21 and Revelation 22, it talks about, behold, the tabernacle of God is with man. There will be no separation between us and Jesus. We will be with Jesus forever. And that's the blessed hope that we have. So what can we do? How can we become more like Jesus? Well, there's this simple principle. By beholding, we become changed.
Shall we bow down our head for our closing prayer? Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this blessed time that we had. Thank you, dear Lord, for giving us excitement and zeal in dwelling upon the life of Jesus. We thank you, dear Lord, for impressing upon our heart this deep truth and for allowing us to grasp the preciousness of it. Father, I pray that we would continue to learn more of Jesus, and not just of Jesus, but truly know him personally as our Savior and as our friend. Thank you, dear Lord, because you desire to be with us, you desire to be our friend, and you are the friend who sticks closer than a brother. Even if everyone else would hate us or despise us, you will stay with us. We thank you so much, dear Lord, for everything that you have done to save us and to have us in heaven with you. Father, we are so undeserving. Nonetheless, we are grateful. Thank you so much, dear Lord, for your love. We ask and we pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.